You good for me to go?
Yep, you're
good
to go.
Awesome. All right. Well, thank you guys. Nice to finally be here. I am guilty. I am a one, although I've been a member for a while. This is my first time here with you guys. Admittedly, we have a real estate investor association out here in Arizona, and it's a phenomenal group. And from what I understand and what I've heard from those guys, that you guys had an amazing group too. So I signed up for the investor association here just off their credibility and just off what we've heard about you guys. So I dabble in there. I throw a few properties in there, but not too much involvement. But now I'm realizing what I'm missing here. So I think you'll probably have to see me, unfortunately, more times than just today.
Hey, we're okay with that.
So, yeah, thank you, guys. And thank you, Shailene. Thank you, Tyler. Thank you, Celeste and Preston, I believe, is the other one that I want to thank just for reaching out and having me do this. I've not done anything like this before. So I prefer to keep things pretty informal. I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'll tell you what we do. But I'm really just here to answer questions and tell you kind of what I do and how I ended up in North Carolina flipping raw vacant land and making money, which for a lot of people, it sounds a little foreign. For a lot of people, it's like, yeah, this is old hat. So the other thing, and it's a little difficult, is there a way, Tyler, for me to see everybody on here at once while I'm talking?
You might be able to go to the top right of your screen and then click on gallery view if you see that somewhere up there.
This blocks all your guys' view though, doesn't it?
Oh yeah. Yeah, probably if you're sharing the screen, it probably blocks everybody.
That's okay. Yeah. It's Sorry. Just here we are, 2020. It's just nice to see who's it'd be nice to see who's falling asleep so I know which direction to go here.
Right. I'll get on to him.
So anyways, my name is Dan Vanderven. I'm originally from Western New York. I at 18, the town I grew up on had about 1,500 people in it. I think the last census, I think they're up to like 1,800. So they're definitely on a huge growth trend. Still no booming cities there. So I knew at an early age I was going to get out of there. I joined the military and was fortunate enough to go to Hawaii. I was stationed in Hawaii for 4 years and did a year overseas deployed. And that's when I realized that you don't have to be cold or miserable for 9 months out of the year. So I decided to go to Virginia, end up Virginia at George Mason University, worked in some government contracting around there, realized how miserable that life was, and got into investing. So we've been out in Arizona now since 2012. We've been investing in fix and flips. We've had some buy and hold rentals around the country. And delinquent mortgages was really where my focus was. So I would buy bad debt from hedge funds. That was great until, like everything, the market turned. And so my wife and I, Emily right here, she jumps horses. So I won't get into any of that. But if anybody here loves horses and you heard that and you're trying to think about selling me a horse, please don't, because that's a daily fight in this house. No, she's just, she jumps horses. Those are our two dogs there, Ranger and Yogi. And what my wife does is she does the data side of this. So there's kind of two ends. There's kind of a front end and a back end. And the front end, which is the data, which is arguably the most important aspect of this. And that's where about 90% of our work goes in. So that's just who we are. We're out in Arizona now. I threw my contact info in the chat also. So if you guys want to reach out anytime after this, I'd love to help you guys out. So why land? Well, I mean, everybody knows, you know, tenants, toilets, you know, it just depends on what your tolerance is. And my tolerance is not for getting phone calls in the middle of the night. And so going the lender route, going the delinquent mortgage route, I thought that would solve things. But next thing you know, you're getting calls from, you're just getting a wider variety of calls. It's not just from one person anymore. So throughout that process, I also own another company out here that I'm selling. It's actually, oddly enough, it's a garbage can cleaning company. I started this out of almost a dare. And here we are 4 years later, and we're the largest company in Phoenix. So we're selling that, and we're full in on land, and here's why. I'm yet to find returns in land that can be beat by any other investing. Now, that doesn't mean that I've got the secret sauce or I have the answer or I've got the best methodology. This is just what works for me. And so, you know, I think land in general, it's not something we look at initially as investing because it's just land. You know, what are you going to do to it? Tyler and I were talking before, he gets phone calls about properties that, you know, he doesn't know how to improve the value or what to do with it. And so there's a lot of options inside of there. And in each side of each one of our land businesses, so of all the colleagues I have, and we each have our own businesses, although we do the same thing, essentially, we run completely different businesses. And that's because there's just a myriad of options within land. So here are just a few. I threw at the end at the bottom there, cannabis. You know, obviously an election has passed or hasn't passed, depending on where you're in the country, but cannabis has become obviously pretty popular. Land for cannabis is going through the roof right now. If you're in Kentucky and you can get on your hands on some land and go through the licensing process for that, you're gonna do okay. Same with California, out here in Arizona, it's popular. So that's becoming pretty big, but then you see the other list here, and these are all just niches. So waterfronts, you know, you have Lake Gaston up there. We've done quite a few mailers up in Lake Gaston. Mobile home parks, RV parks. This is where you can mail for commercial land. And I kind of just gave away the secret as to how we do it. It's mail. And so inside of land, there's everything starts with land. You know, if you're going to put a building somewhere, obviously you need land. So these are the different options. And I will tell you, we do almost none of these. And you can go through it, you can buy land, you can make money in all these different ways. But all we do is just flip land. Do I do anything to improve it? Sometimes. If we're going to do something to improve it, it's going to be typically on the paper side. We will also get land perked, we'll clear land. But for the most part, we're just buying land and flipping it. There's not too much involved that we get into. Now, there's a lot of different strategies here. You can buy and hold. Well, that's a great strategy for us. Our model is get in, get out, double your money, and keep moving. And so the double your money concept, that can work. You know, if you're buying $5,000 or $8,000, $10,000 properties, that's certainly doable. If you're buying a $200,000 property, I wouldn't expect it. However, there's still margins inside of there that we can all work with. You know, out here, if I go to a meeting with an investor, if he gets 8%, he's excited. So with land, the numbers are good enough to where you can be offering 12 to 15% very conservatively and hit those numbers almost in your sleep. So how do we do it? Well, I kind of already gave that secret away. It's the post office and data. So let me get you guys back on here. So data, that's really the key part of this. There's software, there's programs, there's really, in 2020, there's really no reason to guess in real estate. And so data, when I say data, how do we pick a county? We use data. How do we determine the value of a property? We use data. You know, how do we know, which areas, which data acreage ranges inside of a county or a city or a zip code we're going to mail, we use data. So where do we get our data? Well, First American Title is one of the largest data aggregators in the country. And so CoreLogic, TitlePro, DataTree, that's where we get our data. And that's important because you can go anywhere and buy a list. You know, if anybody says, I'm looking to buy a list, their real estate career might be short. And why I say that is because lists are just passed through, they're scrubbed through. Some are old, the data, it depends on what the algorithms are that are, you know, data is only as good as what's being put in. So we purchase fresh data for each one of our mailing campaigns. And our mailing campaigns are thousands of offers going out at once. I will average about 5,000 offers a month right now. How we do that?
Dan, did you say offers?
Yes, these are hard offers with actual numbers on them.
Oh man, okay. You're gonna have to dive into that a little bit, but can we go back? You were listing things and you said First American Title and you listed some others, but they were way too fast for me to write down.
Yeah, so inside First American Title, I believe gets their data from CoreLogic. Black Knight, Title Pride. They're all, I forget who owns which now. A few have moved around, but I use CoreLogic, DataTree, and Title Pro 247. Those are the three sites that I'll use.
Okay.
And so, yeah, we'll put together campaigns, and, you know, we start at the beginning, so it's kind of a funnel. And that's the top of that funnel is where my wife puts the effort in, and she'll go through and she'll, depending on the criteria we're looking for, which again is part of the kind of the secret sauce, the art and the science here. And she'll go through and enter the data, and we'll start drawing counties out of that data based on the metrics we're looking for. Once that's established, we then start breaking it down. We'll break it down by county, which is where we should start. From county, we'll go down to zip code. We'll go down to township. Sometime we'll even get down to the APN level, depending on what county we're in. So you pull all that data together, and now you've got a list of, say, 5,000 landowners in a specific area. How do you price those? Well, again, a little bit of the secret sauce, the art and the science here, is knowing how to scrape data and pull good data from the internet. Again, there's no reason to make to guess here. So what we'll do is we'll assign a retail value to the land, and then from there back into the numbers that we want to make for each property. So what it looks like is a spreadsheet of about 5,000 owners of land. We break that down into smaller chunks, price those, and then send that to a printer so that the landowner will get a 2-page letter. If you're in this group and you own land, I'm sorry if you've gotten any of my letters. They're not meant to be offensive. It's just what we're willing to pay. So we will typically mail, depending on the area, somewhere between, and depending on what we're looking for, somewhere between 15 to 40% of market value. And so, again, that can vary. That can vary by size. That can vary by location. That can vary just from neighborhood to neighborhood. I was telling Tyler before everyone hopped on the call here, with houses, it's a little bit easier in the sense that we know that we can run down a street and I can tell you what the houses are worth within a pretty close percentage, whereas with land, the neighboring parcel could have ditches and steep slopes and not perk, but the one next to it is worth $1 million because it's a commercially zoned property. So land is different and land is tricky. So the big third component to this is local talent. And so I work with local attorneys, local agents. We have a great agent right there in North Carolina in Raleigh. And we lean on her and she leans on us. And the whole goal with this is to pick up cheap land and then sell cheap land. We don't look to stay in these. Like I said, there's other alternatives. You can buy and hold, you can develop, you can sit in, you can subdivide. There's a myriad of options inside of land. We don't get involved in that. We buy the land, we'll clean it up, we'll clean up the title, we'll get it ready to be placed back on the market, and then we sell it. So the hold time on these are not long. And I'll get into a little bit. Here you'll see, this is from July, I'm sorry. And this is just North Carolina at the time. You'll see up here, these are kind of our processes. But in North Carolina, you guys have 100 counties total. We sent 10,000 offers to 5 counties, and here are the numbers. You'll see our average days on market is 68 days and our average ROI is 106%. So this is simply just sending mail. That's really all we do. Now, yes, that's simple, but not easy. And there's a lot of steps in between there. And this is what basically those steps are that I've already went over. Data, fresh data, your processes. We use VAs to search through data for us, to scrub through data. Because when you get a list and you buy a list of say 2000 names, out of those 2000, probably 500 of them aren't gonna get a piece of mail right off the bat. And then you start drilling down from there, and out of those 1500 that are left, maybe 1200 will actually get an offer. And so we used VAs, we use software to do that. And again, in 2020, we don't make guesses. Everything we do is, I don't like this term because it's kind of a buzzword right now and it sounds cheap, but everything's data driven. If I could find a cooler way to say that, I would, but that's just what it is. And like I said, local talent. So we're using agents. Now, I don't just do this in North Carolina. Right now we're in North Carolina, Indiana, Virginia, Georgia, Arizona, California, and Texas. So you can move anywhere in the country with this. And I always joke with people in the industry and I say, you're always 3 weeks out from being out of business and you're 3 weeks away from reinventing your business. The 3 weeks is because that's about how long it takes to buy the data, send it, and put it in the mail and get it on someone's doorstep. So the ability to be nimble within this field is, and your costs be all variable and not fixed is a very attractive aspect of this business. And so we move around a lot. What we typically will do when we stay in an area and why we've enjoyed North Carolina so much, well, first of all, you guys, if in Raleigh, you can check any list in the country and you know you're in the top 10 for growing cities in the US. So that's one reason. There's a lot of different reasons, but really for us, once we have a really good agent and a really good attorney and a really good team in that area, even soil scientist or someone to bush hog or clear land, once you have those components in place and you've done a few deals together, that's when we'll actually stick in an area and stay around. So right now, the three main areas we're in are North Carolina, Georgia, and Virginia. The other ones we have property in, we're still actively investing. However, you get too spread, you can spread yourself too thin. Let's just put it that way. And putting out 5,000 offers a month, it's not easy. So as you add markets to that, your mail count needs to go up. And that's, Excel's okay. And I'm decent with Excel, but I don't plan to live inside of there. And once you get to 5,000 a month, until you can start offloading that, it gets a little hectic. So part of that 5,000 a month and sending that mail, that's really the magic behind the business. And it's an art and a science, like I've said. It's also just a crapshoot. We're mailing to landowners that either love their property and were the biggest jerks in the world for ever making them an offer that's not 50,000 more than what they think it is. But more times than not, we're just someone, it's almost like a garage sale for land. Now, when you go to a garage sale, someone's selling a painting for $5, they bought it for $50. Well, why would they do that? It's just convenience. We offer and we pay straight cash. We close quickly and we don't mess around. So when you're looking at someone who owns a property for say it's worth $20,000 and they live out of state and they've never seen it, they inherit it from their uncle, and they pay taxes on it every year and it's just a thorn in their side. They don't know what to do with it. They don't know if they're gonna sell it. No agent wants to sell it because it's a $15,000, $20,000 piece of land. And then we come in with a piece of mail that says, hey, I'll give you cash for that. So you can put together the perfect mailing campaign and you can do everything right and you can get zero calls. Well, you're always gonna get the calls of people telling you to go somewhere.
Close off.
Yeah. However, you could also mess up an entire mailer and get 50 phone calls and pull a deal out. So the point being is when I say art and science, it's because it's a little bit of guesswork too. So there's a lot of work behind the scenes here. And I say simple but not easy, and I don't mean to oversimplify the process, but for this, just for this presentation, we can get deep into a lot of weeds, and I'd love to hear you guys' questions here in a few minutes, and we'll do that. But this is basically our business model. And so here's my contact info. Let me just see if there's any other things I had on here. I think we went over data. Oh, the last thing I want to go real quick before we open up to questions. I put in my bio when Celeste asked, what do I want to convey? One of the things I put in there was, what's in it for you guys? Well, I'm mailing North Carolina regardless. As soon as I get off this call, I'll probably put another, I think we're looking at 2,100 more spread throughout a few counties around Raleigh. So we're going to be dropping mail in those counties regardless. If you guys, I tell people, put your orders in. If there's something you're looking for, if there's something you have a client that's looking for, if you have a project in mind, if you just want to maybe buy some land yourself, if you want to get into wholesaling, all those are options here. And all you really need to do is send me an email. I do this for people all around the country. I do it for friends. I do it for agents. I've even done it for an enemy, somewhat of an enemy. But it's really this simple. You tell me what you're looking for. And as long as we're mailing that area, I'll just drop it in the mail. And anything that comes back that fits kind of your criteria, I'll just let you know, here's what we got. So from my standpoint, I'm going to be doing this anyways. And if I can help somebody pick up a piece of land cheap and move it cheap, that's a win-win-win for everybody.
Cool. That sounds great. I've got some questions, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
I'll get us started. If you guys want to put some questions in the chat box, or if you want to speak up, you know, I'm sure Dan will be happy to answer those questions for you. This might be getting into the weeds a little bit, but I'm interested in VAs.
Yeah.
So how do you find a virtual assistant? What qualities do you look for? How do you vet them? That kind of stuff.
Well, you're going to lose a little bit of money, and you're going to find some patience.
Okay.
And so, you know, with a VA, it's tricky. There's a company called Landmasters. They're out of the Philippines, actually. And they can do darn near anything you want with land. I think it's $4 an hour. They'll give you a coupon for $3 an hour. I decline it just because I didn't want to take that coupon. But they'll do a lot of due diligence for you. For example, when I'm mailing waterfront properties, I will use the software. I'll draw, basically there's a drawing tool and you can draw an outline around the lakes.
Mm-hmm.
And then I send that to the VAs and I say, pull out only the properties that touch water. And they will pull out every single property that touches water. Because as you know, you're mailing for waterfronts, an acre of land on the water can be worth $100,000. Across the street, it's worth 10.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So part of this is when I talk about data, you know, we're not sending $500 an acre offers to properties in Manhattan.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we're also not sending $500,000 acres to a 5-acre parcel in, you know, the middle of Kansas.
Right.
So VAs, they're out there. There's plenty, especially with data today. They can get their hands on anything from anyone in the world. And you don't actually, you know, I make all the personal phone calls in my business. That's by choice. Obviously, if someone's selling their land, they want to be able to communicate with you properly. However, behind the scenes, you don't need that. And you can get a lot of I call it the grunt work, done by VAs very, very efficiently and very cheaply.
Gotcha. So that's for land specifically. Do you have anybody that specializes in like other real estate, like homes, rental properties, that kind of stuff?
I do have a guy right now. He works for my buddy and he does direct mail campaigns out in Arizona. He's actually going to not be doing direct mail campaigns and that guy will need some work. So shoot me an email and I'll connect you guys.
Okay, gotcha.
He's looking for about 20 to 40 hours a week of work.
Okay, got that. Will he work for $4 an hour?
that one I'm not sure, but I can. Okay. All right. You know, negotiate, right? Let's see how good your negotiation skills are.
Can I use your coupon?
Yeah. Please do.
Okay. So when you're marketing for areas, what exactly are you looking for? Are you looking for good school districts? Are you looking for population growth? Are you looking for job growth? What is it that piques your interest?
So now you're getting into the secret sauce here. So
don't tell us anything proprietary. Just kind of give us an idea of.
I'll share anything with anybody. There's just to give you an idea. There's 3,400 counties in this country. I think it's 3,420 or somewhere around there. We have data on about 3,395 of those. I know probably of 2,000 land investors in the country. And so every single one of person in this call could come on and do what I do and send 10,000 pieces a month, and we still wouldn't even run into each other.
Yeah.
So I'm happy to share anything. To answer your question, what are we looking for? We've got probably about, I think we're up to 16 criteria now that we look for. We're looking for how much land is being sold in comparison to how many properties there are. How many people are moving in? How many people are moving out? You know, U-Haul is a great place for data. who does everybody use when they move? Well, about 90% of people use U-Haul, and they can track all that data. So we look for, you're right, population growth. We're looking for days on market. We're looking for schools, like you said, within the county. Once we drill down to that level, we'll get into the school districts. So we've got a variety of metrics that we look for. We also look for, if we're going to mail Nash County and we're going to send to the 5 to 20 acre parcels, you know, is there only 200 pieces or are there 2,000? Because when you're trying to send out 5,000 pieces of mail, you can't spend all day trying to price, you know, 50 different areas because they only have 100 different properties in them.
Right.
So there's a little bit of that in there also, which is the point of that is to help yourself from going crazy trying to price, you know, 50 different areas.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Deneen says, what was the percentage range of market value that you said you offer potential land sellers?
We're looking, depending on the project, depending on the area, depending on the size, 15 to 40%.
Okay. I'm just thinking how you would get that. I mean, you can go on the county GIS and look up tax value for the land, and I guess base it off of that. Is there a better way to do it?
Yeah, we don't actually use tax value. We don't use assessed value. The reason being is kind of what I mentioned earlier. If I'm going to go off assessed value, that's operating under the assumption that property A is very similar to property B, is very similar to property C. So the assessment, you know, for example, if a property is landlocked, it might be worth $4,000 and the property in front of it has road frontage and it's worth $25,000.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to throw that $4,000 assessed value out. And I also don't want to send them an offer for $1,000 because what if there's an easement that I don't know about?
Right.
What if there's a pathway? What if there's access? What if there's a creek? What if there's trees? What if there's a cabin? What if, you know, there's all sorts of reasons as to why you may or may not want to buy that land. So what we do is we use market value. And we, like I said, we use local talent and our local experience, you know, and North Carolina, we've done, I think we're putting 25 deals, what, our 25th deal here today.
Mm-hmm.
That gives us a lot of data. And that tells us a lot about what land is moving for around Raleigh. So the longer you do this, the longer you stay in an area, the easier it will get.
Gotcha. Caroline and Carly had a question. What is the process to divide a parcel and sell lots?
How much time do you have?
It probably varies all over the country, I imagine.
It does, yeah. So it varies depending on where you are in the country, depending all the way down to the county, all the way down to the size of the land. In Texas, if you have a parcel that's 5 acres, that is seen differently than a parcel that's 5.01 acres. And so you can parcel a 5.01 acre out in certain counties in Texas a lot easier than a 5 acre. So okay. The process is, you know, get a survey done. You know, you'll run through the county, go through the paperwork. I always start at the county level. I call the counties constantly. I don't know if people here deal with a lot of people at the county level, but I will tell you that across the country, the people working at these county offices, they love to help.
Mm-hmm.
And I call them and I get so much information. We have great conversations. I've got people in these offices that know me now, and they will give you a lot of the information you're looking for, and they will guide you in the right direction. So we lean on them heavily.
Gotcha. And Preston, I'm going to come to you after this question, just see if maybe you have some more local advice. Shailene says, what does your due diligence process look like once an owner agrees to your offer letter?
Oh, good question. Yeah. So the process, you know, we send out letters, and there's a place on the letter. You know, I there's one gotta be laying around here somewhere. It has the price right on there, the legal description, and they're personalized letters. So we use auto fields that populate these letters. And so it looks like it's an actual, it's a letter that's designed for their property. Now, 99% of these mailers we're gonna get wrong. You know, I'm gonna send someone that's worth 100 grand, I might send them an offer for 10. You know, those anomalies are in there. And those people are not gonna be happy, which for whatever reason. So, the due diligence process, once a letter comes in or someone calls in and they say, yes, I'd like to sell my property, that's when we'll start using our software. We've got, we've got 7 software programs that we use. I use heavily about 3 or 4 of them. And what I'm doing there is I'm checking the title. You know, I'm using Title Pro 247. I'm going to go back and find out what's going on there. I'm going to look at the floodplain. I'm going to look at the slope. I'm going to look at the comps in the area. Let's see what's moving around there. I'm going to look at the soils. I'm going to go to the USDA site. Are the soils on this land similar to the ones next door? Are they, if it's a 2-letter identifier in North Carolina, on the soil, head for the hills.
Wait, what does that mean? A 2-letter identifier?
Oh, I'm sorry. So for soils, if you see the soil in North Carolina, that's RA.
Okay.
It's only 2 letters as opposed to BEC. That's a code. Okay. RA is going to be wetlands. You're going to want to head for the hills on that one.
Okay, gotcha.
So then we get into the local tab. We talk to our local agent. She'll go by. We'll send a photographer out there with a drone. Spend $100. Go send someone out there. You'll get aerial photos for $100 to $150. And there's no better substitute. You know, if you're about to buy a piece of land for $20,000 and you're worried about investing $150 into it to see if there's a burnt down shack on there or whatever the case may be, then maybe it's not the right investing strategy for you. So right. We put a little bit of money into these. We also look at perk tests. So we'll get a soil scientist involved. So our due diligence process is not that difficult. I can typically tell you if someone calls in or sends a letter, I can tell you within 20 to 30 minutes if I'm going to buy that property.
Gotcha. Shailene, does that help?
Does. I guess especially hearing the list that you give to the person on the ground, since you're doing this all over the country, I guess you're a realtor and then you find a photographer and then you call the county, that makes it a lot more clear.
Yeah,
and you're going to see every single piece of land that you put a contract on.
Yeah, Shailene's over there building a list of how he does it, and she's got about a third of it already down. So she'll be flipping land here probably by the end of the week. Yeah, there. You know, and the other thing is we're buying this so cheap. If you buy something at 20% and you screw it up, how bad are you gonna get? How bad are you gonna get hurt?
Not bad, if any.
Yeah.
If at all. Preston, you want to tell us a little bit about local stuff and how you would divide parcels?
Yeah, it's county approval. So you figure out what you want to do with it. You take it to the local planning board and you submit them a plan. So you're going to need a surveyor to do that because they're going to map it out. So anything less than 5 acres needs to be approved in North Carolina. It is a general rule.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. Thank you. Carolyn and Carly said, if a property is landlocked, how do you find if there's an easement? I guess you go to the county, I mean, I go to the county website and look up there.
Yeah, yeah, county website, Title Pro 247, the software program we use, that will also have it. I will just ask the seller also.
Okay.
You know, most of these people, they want to sell their land. They're not calling you because they want to find a reason not to. And so I have no problem asking the seller, you know, send me, email me any documentation that you have. But you're right, you can find most of that at the county level.
Okay, gotcha. Do you look at quarter acre plots in neighborhoods or just large lots?
So quarter acres, those are going to be typically your infill lots. I am not messing with infill lots right now. That's more of a market decision. And so I stay away from those right now. We just strictly, for the most part, 5 acre and up parcels that gotcha. We're looking for. And we're also, we don't mail so much for size. We mail for price.
Gotcha.
So if there's an area in, you know, out here in Arizona, we call it squares on a map. It's just, you know, the desert is just chopped up as a checkerboard out here. And so you can buy 10 acres out here for $250 an acre and $2,500, but you're going to sell it for $7,500. Okay, that's right. Great. But you can do the same amount of work and buy something for 10 grand and sell it for 40.
Right, absolutely. What is the process to have the state take over a private road? And will lenders make a mortgage for a home on a private gravel road?
Those are great questions for someone else. I apologize, but I would be leading you down the wrong road if I tried to answer those.
Gotcha. No worries. Maybe we'll ask Preston about that in a minute. Can we see the slide again where you had the North Carolina properties list on it? So to divide more than 5 acres, the plan does not need to be approved. Preston, I guess that's a question for you.
Anything more than 10 acres does not need approval anywhere. Locally, it's 5 acres. So that's the real answer. If you're going to be splitting anything up, you need to check with the local county or planning board first, and they'll tell you what their requirements are. But yeah, around here, generally, if it's more than 5 acres, if the resulting lot is going to be more than 5 acres, you do not need to have a subdivision plan.
Okay.
Approved.
Gotcha. And if it's over 10 acres, you don't need it pretty much anywhere.
Approved. Correct.
Okay. Gotcha. All right. Dan, you want to tell us a little bit about this slide again one more time?
Yeah, absolutely. So I breezed through it a little bit here. So the key drivers here, you'll see acquisition, engineering, sales, location. So the acquisition process is what I went through with the data. Engineering is the due diligence, and then obviously selling it. So these are 10 properties that we had up through July. You'll see the property cost, our closing cost, and then our all in. And then our sale price, net profit, and return on investment there. You'll see the average days on market, we're averaging the 68. So what I'm showing here, and what I use this for when speaking with other investors, is this is just one of the states that we're operating in. And this is just 10,000 offers sent to 5 counties.
Gotcha.
To give you an idea, it costs 65 cents to send an offer.
Are these sorted in any way or just kind of randomly on there?
These are just random 10 that we pulled out.
Okay, gotcha.
They're actually, I believe they're in order of, they look like, I can remember most of these or something. They're in order of date as far as oldest to newest.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Okay, cool. Do you guys have any other questions for Dan or any other questions for the group? Why is the net profit low? And I guess it's really because there's really not a lot you're putting into it, right?
What was the question? I'm sorry.
The last one, it says, why is the net profit low?
I think that's because it's an average.
Yeah.
The lower is pulling down the high. One is like 4,000 and one is 60,000. So you're averaging that out. That's pretty high.
Yeah. I mean, you're doubling your money. It looks like 106% return. So you're doubling money on average. So, I mean, you win some, you lose some.
Yeah, yeah. You know, our lowest one here is 14% ROI. And, you know, that in our world is failing. Anything under 50% is failing to us.
Oh, I'd love to get those returns. All right, cool. Do you guys have any other questions?
Yeah. And if anybody wants to reach out, there it is. Send me an email. That's the office line. You'll reach a receptionist there and just let them know who you are and leave your name and number. I'll call you back. I also put my cell phone number in the chat. But yeah, if anybody has any questions, they'd like to, like I say, put an order in or just ask me about some land they're looking at buying or maybe an offer they had. Or if you have some land you want to sell, I recommend you go sell it on the open market. But, you know, maybe you need some quick cash. So anyways, thank you guys for having me. And like I said, you'll unfortunately have to see my face a little bit more because it looks like there's a lot of value you guys have here.
Cool. Well, thank you for doing
this. Thanks so much, Dan.
Yeah, thank you. And you mentioned the market. So what is the market like for land right now?
Yeah, great question. You know, I actually had that in my notes here, and that's one thing that I love talking about. Land right now, traffic for land in general is up online. And so, again, using data, we look at how many properties, which properties are getting clicks, how many clicks are they getting, how many views are they getting, how many views, clicks, and saves does it mean before you get a sale? So everything we're seeing in the data trend for land is trending in a positive direction. The reason being, in our theory, and the data kind of bears some of this out, is you're seeing cities flatten out a little bit. Mm-hmm. You're seeing people realize that, look at us right here. I mean, if I told you guys a year ago, I can't make it to the meeting, I'm gonna do it on Zoom, you'd be like, yeah, okay, we'll go find somebody else. You know? And now this is 2020 and people have learned that I don't need to be in an office every day. I don't need to commute, you know, or live downtown and pay exorbitant housing prices. I can live outside of the city and maybe only travel in 2 or 3 days a week instead of 5 or 6.
Right.
So flattening out those cities has allowed for land to become pretty popular in the mm-hmm. real estate investing world. And we're getting a lot of calls. It's frankly right now, we're getting properties that we didn't think we would buy at the prices we're buying, and we're selling them quicker for more than we expect.
Wow, that's awesome. That's great.
It's just a function, I think, of a new marketplace, you know, and also you have people, unfortunately, that need cash.
Right.
So it's kind of a little bit of the perfect storm here for land right now.
Cool. Well, again, thank you for doing this. Now, guys, again, if you want to save the chat box, go ahead and click on that button at the bottom right-hand part of the chat and click on Save Chat so you can save everybody's information. Well, thank you for doing this, Dan. We really appreciate it. Hope to see you again at some of the meetings coming up.
Yeah, thank you guys very much. Thanks for everybody for hanging out. And I hope I can't see too many faces, but hopefully we didn't get too many nodding off, you know?
Yeah. No, I poked him or something. Okay. Thanks, man. Everybody, all right, guys, have a good day.
Take care.
Bye-bye.